Okay, thank you, Julien and Serge, for inviting me here. I'm from Maastricht University in the School of Health Professions Education. So most of my research nowadays is in health professions, medical students, residents, but also physiotherapy, dentistry, fields like that. And many of the projects we do are very similar to the projects that Susan and Roger have been talking about. But I made another decision. I will not give you an overview of all those projects, but I'd focus a bit more on the underlying design and theory. And I start from a problem, because you had an excellent question, I think. What is the problem we are trying to solve? And why do we think that technology or particular approaches might help us to solve that problem? Well, for me, the problem I'm trying to solve is rather straightforward. Namely, that students are often not able to apply the things they have learned in practice, in the profession, in daily life. We often see an extremely low transfer of learning from the university, from school, to practice. In the medical field, it's not uncommon that students study for 6 years, and then they are doing some work in the hospital, and the first thing their supervisor is saying is, well, forget all about these things you learned in the medical school. Here we do it our way. So that's not what we should aim at. We should try to improve transfer of learning from university, from school, to daily life and practice. If I'm not clear, please interrupt me. So if you have questions, raise your hand, and there's no need to have all the questions afterwards. I think it's easier to have them while I'm talking. So raise your hand when you don't understand me or when you have questions. So this is the problem. And 25 years ago, I became interested in this problem, and I became interested in answering the question, how could we solve this problem? How could we better prepare students for future professions and for daily life, help them to be able to transfer the things they learn outside of the university, outside of school? And I came up with a number of reasons for low transfer of learning. And I won't discuss them all, but I'll focus on one particularly important explanation for low transfer of learning, which has to do with fragmentation in our educational system. When we are teaching about complex domains, when we are teaching problem solving, reasoning, decision making, and things like that, we have the tendency to simplify this complex domain by putting it into smaller pieces and even smaller pieces, and then teach it piece by piece. So I call this an atomistic model. And this yields education that is fragmented. Suppose I'm describing this figure here. When I would do this in an atomistic way, I would describe each red dot, and for each red dot, I could describe how it moves across the screen. And I could do the same for all the green dots. And after I've described all the dots, I could say, well, now you know everything about this domain, because I've described it all. My claim is that when I approach teaching like this, you will still have no idea what I'm talking about. So I think we must replace this atomistic approach to teaching with a more holistic model, looking at the whole. So we should try to analyze complex learning domains in coherence, not focusing on the separate pieces, but also focusing on the relationships between the pieces. How are things interrelated? And then try to teach from relatively simple to more and more complex meaningful holes, always taking the relationships between the elements into account. Well, this is not a new idea, of course. I have a background in psychology, and then I studied Gestalt psychology. They already had this famous saying, the whole is more than the sum of its parts. And I think this is something that we should really take seriously in education. The whole is more than the sum of its parts. And we must help our students to see the wholes, to see the relationships between all the elements we are teaching to them. I will focus a bit on clinical reasoning, because this is a summer school on reasoning as one example of a complex skill, a complex domain. And when we are teaching clinical reasoning or diagnostic reasoning, we also often see an atomistic approach. For example, we can look at all the different fallacies and biases that are important in clinical reasoning. I listed only a few, the anchoring bias, the infallibility bias, the confirmation bias, the diagnosis momentum bias, and I can go on. And I've seen many courses for medical residents or for medical doctors starting from this list. And then we are teaching about all these biases and giving examples. And doctors typically find this very interesting. They say, oh, very interesting course. I never knew about these things. They're very helpful. And they go back to practice, and it doesn't make any difference. They forget about it, and they do their clinical reasoning as they did before. So we must find another way to teach it. This doesn't work. And the model I developed as an attempt to improve transfer of learning is called four-component instructional design. And this is used in many of the projects we run in our school. As a starting point for designing learning environments, as a starting point for designing technology-enhanced learning environments, but also regular courses or learning trajectories for our students and our residents. Well, this book focuses on the psychological basis of this model, and I will say a little bit more about it later. And this is a more practical approach to using the model. And as the name of the model already indicates, the basic claim is that learning environments can be described as being built from four components. I call them learning tasks, supportive information, procedural information, and part task practice. And the learning tasks are actually the backbone of an educational program. And the other components are connected to this backbone. So let's have a look at an educational program aimed at transfer of learning. Very simple. It's nothing more than a series of what I call learning tasks. And these learning tasks can be problems that we pose to students, or projects on which small groups of students work, or other cases that must be studied, so it's a generic term. But the first claim is that well-designed learning tasks are based on authentic real-life tasks. So they should reflect the complexity that students also encounter in the profession or in the real world. Real-life tasks are almost always integrative. They make an appeal on both knowledge, skills, and often also attitudes. So they force students to integrate the elements that are relevant to solve problems in a particular domain, in my case, usually the medical or health sciences domain. And the most important learning process is inductive learning. I visited some of the lectures yesterday, and they were also talking about inductive learning. So it's students learning from concrete experiences by generalizing and abstracting away from those concrete experiences. If we want our students to learn reasoning, they do so by reasoning on the basis of concrete cases. So inductive learning is key here. Well, an educational program is more than a series of problems or learning tasks. We must make a number of pose a number of requirements. This is what could be a learning task for clinical reasoning. Well, we can all have an idea of what it looks like. This is about a 15-year-old boy. He had a knee operation, and during the operation, something is going wrong. So the clinical reasoning is finding out what is going wrong and what to do about this undesirable situation in order to save this boy. It's one example of a learning task. This is a very simple example. In my university, we use problem-based learning, and our students do a lot of their work on the basis of problems like this. So we use these problems, which are text-based, simple problems, in order to help them with clinical reasoning. But of course, we can also use computer-based virtual patients. We have seen some examples of these virtual patients in the presentation of Susan. We can use trained actors, simulated, standardized patients, who are trained actors who are playing to be a patient. We can use high-fidelity simulation. We can use real patients, of course. But basically, it's all the same thing. It's all simulation. This is extremely low-fidelity simulation. This is the real thing, and this is in between. I think that virtual patients and high-fidelity simulation can be very engaging and can really make a difference in learning. But there are also risks involved. When I have first-year medical students, there have been a lot of experiments showing that these first-year medical students with very little knowledge about the domain typically learn more from these text-based cases than from high-fidelity, fancy technological environments, because they are mainly confused by all the irrelevant details in such a high-fidelity environment. So what's best to use also depends on the prior knowledge and the experience of your learners. And when I'm designing educational programs, you will typically see that there is an increase of fidelity if learners acquire more expertise. Okay, let's go back to this idea of learning tasks, which can be text-based or high-fidelity simulation or whatever. What requirements must be posed to the learning task from a cognitive science point of view? I think the first one is variation. Variability of practice has repeatedly shown to be the most important factor predicting transfer of learning. If there is no variation in practice, there will be no transfer. It's simple like that. And there is strong empirical evidence for this. So I simply indicate this by putting these triangles in the learning tasks to make clear that the learning tasks should be different from each other on all the dimensions on which real-life tasks are also different from each other. They must be different from each other on surface features, when we look at this, we all say, well, these are butterflies. Despite the fact that some are large and some are small and some are yellow and some are red. So color and size are surface features because they differ on these features, but we still call them all butterflies. How did we learn this? Well, our parents, when they had to walk with us, would have said, well, look, this is a beautiful butterfly. Ah, here is another one. It's also a beautiful butterfly. So by being confronted with different examples of butterflies, we found out which were the surface features which are not necessary to call a particular insect a butterfly. For learning tasks, it's the same way. Many tasks might at first sight look different from each other, but nevertheless they can be performed in the same way. And we can only learn this thanks to variation in the set of tasks we are working on. Of course, learning tasks must also differ from each other on structural features. You will all agree that this is not a butterfly, because it's different on a number of structural features from the insects here. And we need variation on both in order to support this process of induction, of inductive learning, yielding cognitive schemas that make it possible to apply the things we have learned to new situations. That's transfer of learning. If you go back to these butterflies, when you go to the Amazon and you've never been there before, and you see an insect flying, you might say, oh, this is a beautiful butterfly. I have never seen one like this before. And this is proving transfer of learning. That you say, it is a butterfly, but I've never seen one like this before. And that's only possible through this inductive learning, this abstracting and generalizing away from the concrete tasks. Yes? Yes? Yeah. Yes. Yeah. That's one of the requirements we must pose to the tasks that we provide to our learners. So if we translate this to teaching clinical reasoning, we must make sure that students must reach the same diagnosis for a variety of cases that differ on surface features. But we must also make sure that students must reach different diagnoses for a number of cases that at first sight might look very similar to each other. And as long as this requirement is not met, we cannot expect good transfer of learning from our teaching situation to the real world or the profession. And luckily, in the medical field, we have a lot of books like this, which only contain case studies. And often these books are not very well designed from a cognitive science point of view, but at least there is an attempt to provide students with a wide variety of cases. The second requirement has to do with the complexity of the learning tasks. It should be clear that it doesn't make sense to give a highly complex task, a highly complex case to a first-year medical student. You couldn't make any meaning out of it. So, the basic idea is that in an educational program, we start with relatively simple tasks or scenarios or cases or whatever you would call it. And we increase complexity until we reach the level of complexity of a beginning professional or the final attainment level that we set for our course or program. So we sequence tasks from simple to complex. Ideally, even the simplest tasks are representative for tasks that a professional medical doctor could come across in the real world. It could be recognizing a simple child's disease or something like that. And we need variation on each level of complexity. Otherwise, there will be no transfer. So on each level of complexity, we need variation, but then the tasks become more complex. In education, this approach is also known as the spiral curriculum. And 100 years ago, educationalists were already talking about the idea of a spiral curriculum, where students first work on relatively simple tasks and then on more and more complex tasks until they reach the level of complexity that's the final attainment level of the program. So we are building this schematic structure. Now we have the learning task with the variation and the levels of complexity building up throughout the program. It's not that easy to determine the complexity of tasks. In mathematics, it might be relatively easy looking at the number of elements and how they interact. But for real life tasks, it's typically an empirical question. And what I often do is have a discussion, a meeting with experts in the domain, and trying to find out what makes the tasks in this particular domain simpler or more complex, and then figure out which factors affect the complexity and use these factors to build this structure from relatively simple to more and more complex tasks. And these factors are very different between one medical domain and another medical domain. This is one example, the X-ray difficulty scale that is used to rate the difficulty of X-rays. And of course, diagnostic reasoning on the basis of X-rays is not only done by radiologists, but also by many other medical specialties. And then we are looking at things like, it's difficult to read, but the degree of typicalness of the X-ray. Are there any artifacts? What is the technical quality? And so on. So there are many factors that you should take into account to say something about the difficulty, the complexity of diagnosing a particular X-ray. And using this instrument that is filled out by a group of experts, we can, well, maybe determine the complexity of 1,000 X-rays and then cluster those X-rays in from the very simple ones to the more and more complex ones, and that will be the sequence that we use in our educational program. Then there is one more requirement to our learning tasks dealing with support and guidance, or scaffolding. I think Roger and Susan used the word scaffolding. Here the idea is that when students go from one level of complexity to another level of complexity, so it's between these complexity levels, when they go to this higher level of complexity, they've never been working on this higher level of complexity, they first need a lot of support and guidance from a teacher or from their instructional materials. Otherwise, they will not be able to perform this task without the scaffold. And I indicate this by this filling of this circle. And then for a next task at the same level of complexity, they are given less support and guidance. So scaffolding in the sense of smoothly decreasing the support and guidance that you give to your students. And then for another task, they receive even less support and guidance. And then they might be able to perform the task at this level of complexity without any support and guidance, and independently. And when they show that they are able to perform the task at a particular level of complexity independently without any help, they can go on to a higher level of complexity. But when they start to work on more complex tasks, again, they first need help from their teacher, help from their instructional materials, and again, it's decreasing. So this sets the backbone of our educational program. It's a set of cases or learning tasks that show variability on surface and structural features, that is ordered from lower to more and more complex levels. And on each level of complexity, learners first get a lot of support and guidance, and this decreases until they are able to perform tasks independently, and then they continue to a higher level of complexity. And of course, it's nice if we do a kind of stealth assessments here, yeah, because this would allow us to make decisions on when students can go to a higher level of complexity without explicitly testing them. And we have these information about our students directly available, we can make this whole process adaptive. Well, this guidance, it's like these training wheels on the bike of a child. First you ride this bike with the wheels, and then you put them up a little bit, and then you can get rid of those training wheels. Well, this idea of increasing complexity, or the spiral curriculum, is an old idea. This is also an old idea. When you study Vygotsky, he was already talking about the soul of proximal development, asking himself, when do students learn most? And he came up with this idea. Students learn most when we give them tasks that are actually too difficult for them. It's in their soul of proximal development. But thanks to the fact that we help them, support them, guide them, they are able to complete the task. So all these learning tasks should be challenging tasks. They should really challenge the learners to take a next step beyond the things they are already able to do. But then they need this support and guidance in order to complete the task. And when we look at the whole educational program, it's typically this sawtooth pattern where we see decreasing support and guidance again and again for each higher level of complexity. Yes? There are many different things you can do to scaffold learning. It can be scaffolding by peers. It can be scaffolding by teachers. It can also be scaffolding in the instructional materials. And I have an example of this. One of the many examples I could give of how to scaffold learning. This proved to be a very powerful way of scaffolding in many experiments. We first give students modeling examples, showing them an expert solving the problem and explaining how the problem is solved and which cognitive strategies and which heuristics are used to solve the problem. We also give modeling examples with eye movements, for example. So that as a student in radiology, I see an expert radiologist doing a diagnosis on an X-ray. and not only explaining how he is viewing the X-ray and explaining what the process is, but also showing the eye movements of the radiologist, so that you, as a student, can see what the radiologist is looking at. So that might be a way of, well, scaffolding, and it's really the maximum amount of scaffolding, but as a student, because as a student, I'm not solving the problem myself, but I'm studying someone, solving the problem, doing the reasoning and explaining the reasoning process to me. And then in a second phase, it might be the student who is doing the diagnostic reasoning, but I am guiding the student through this reasoning process by asking leading questions. So making sure that the student is going through the reasoning process in a systematic fashion. And then in the end, the students must do it independently. So this is one way, but there are many more ways of providing scaffolding to learn. Yes? No, it's okay. It can be both. I mean, when we look at this structure, we could say, well, I have a pretty homogeneous group of students. So I suppose that all these students will have more or less similar learning processes, and I can set up an educational program where all students are working on the same learning tasks. I can also say, well, I don't believe this. I really want individualized learning trajectories. And it doesn't really change this structure, but it means that one student might need not three, but five learning tasks at this level of complexity. Or one student needs more support for a number of tasks than another student. So the basic structure is staying the same, but I can make it adaptive and implement individualized learning trajectories for different students. And the model as such has been applied for both situations. Okay, so this is actually the backbone of an educational program. And again, what's not uncommon is that in the beginning, students are mainly working on text-based cases and things like that. And when they continue, we bring in more and more real-world things by using simulation, high-fidelity simulation, so that students are credibly introduced to working in a hospital or in the practice of a dentist or something like that. Then we have three more components that are connected to this backbone. And when I give this lecture to teachers, they will typically say, well, this is all nice and easy, students working on these cases and learning tasks, but first they need the theory. Well, that makes a bit of sense. That's what I call the supportive information. It's the information that students need, it's the theory that students need, because it enables them to work on the learning tasks. It's the information that's typically given in lectures, like I'm doing right here. It's the information that you can find in books or on the internet. It's the things you read, the things you study, because it helps you to perform the tasks. In this model, it is the information that helps you with the reasoning and problem-solving aspects of the task, and it's knowledge about the domain, how is the domain organized, and it's knowledge about how to systematically solve problems in the domain. So it's not only knowledge about the domain itself, but also knowledge about how to act in the domain. In our schematic representation, refined strategies for acting in the domain. So this spiral approach that we see for the learning tasks, we also see for the supportive information. The more complex tasks you work on, the more knowledge of the domain you need. The basic learning process here is not inductive learning anymore. It's not learning from concrete experiences, but it's what we call elaboration. It's connecting the information you find in these books or on the internet to the things you already know. So prior knowledge activation is important so that you can connect this new information to the things you already know to form new cognitive schemas. Elaboration as a basic learning process for supportive information. Then there is one more interesting thing. When we look at these L-shaped figures, the model makes it possible to present this supportive information before students start to work on the tasks, which is what you typically find in project-based learning. Students first study some articles, have some lectures, and then they start to work on the project. But in this model, it's also possible that students are immediately confronted with cases or learning tasks. And when they get stuck, they can consult the supportive information. That's actually what we do at my university, which is a problem-based learning university. We present problems to our students, and then they identify learning issues. What do we need to know in order to be able to solve this problem? And they go to what we call the study landscape in order to study the information that helps them to solve the problem. From a cognitive point of view, you could say that for novice students who don't have any knowledge about the domain, going from the problems to the information is typically most effective. Because when I start to give lectures to students who don't know anything about the domain, they don't understand what I'm talking about. But when students have more knowledge about the domain, it can become more effective to start with giving them the information, because then they already have the prior knowledge that enables them to understand the information and then work on the problems. Yeah, does that make sense? Well, when we are teaching clinical reasoning, of course, students learning clinical reasoning need knowledge about the domain, which is for them knowledge of the human body and all the processes in the human body and how the heart-lung system works and how the digestive system works. And they need this knowledge in order to be able to reason. Also need knowledge about diseases, about medications, the effects of medication, and so on. But they also need systematic approaches to solve problem solving, how to do the reasoning in this domain in a systematic fashion that enables them to develop cognitive strategies. So mental models of the domain and cognitive strategies are both necessary in order to become good in clinical reasoning in the domain. And we have many of these systematic approaches to problem solving in medicine. Susan already mentioned the ABC or ABCDE approach, which is an approach that is particularly relevant when you do clinical reasoning in emergency situations where there is a lot of time pressure. And then you must check for the airway, for the breathing, for the circulation, for disabilities, and so on, in order to stabilize the patient. When you have more time and when there is no big time pressure, you will use other cognitive strategies with other systematic approaches. So you also need to teach these systematic approaches that help your students to do clinical reasoning in a number of different contexts. Third component in the model is what is called procedural information. This supportive information mainly helps students with the reasoning, problem-solving aspects of the tasks. But in many domains, especially the medical domains, these learning tasks also have routine aspects. Particular aspects that are actually the same for all tasks. In medicine, all these patients are different. They all have different symptoms. They all have different diagnoses. But some things are always the same. When I measure the blood pressure, it's a routine. When I do palpitation of the stomach, it's always the same. When I do an intravenous injection, it's always the same. When I do reanimation or CPR, it's always the same, independent of the task. For these routine aspects, teaching takes place in another way. For routine aspects, it's best to tell students how to perform these routine aspects just in time, while they are doing it. This is the typical setup. It's a student and a patient or someone playing to be the patient, and there is a supervisor, and the supervisor is closely watching and saying, no, now you should do this. Now take this instrument. Now you should touch the patient here. So this procedural information is best presented just in time, precisely when the students need it during practice. Also in residency training of residents, they do a lot of the things under supervision, and what the supervisor is doing is closely watching and pointing out how to do it and giving immediate feedback when errors are made. The supervisor will not present supportive information here. He will probably not start to explain how the heart-lung system works. No, he's focusing on the routine aspects of behavior. In the figure, this is indicated by these dark blocks with the arrows indicating that is how two instructions, this procedural information, is given to the learners while they are performing the tasks. And here there is another learning process active, knowledge compilation. ACT and SOAR have been mentioned several times. And knowledge compilation has been very well described in the ACT system of John Anderson, describing how declarative representations are translated into cognitive rules. And that's what we're trying to do here. We are giving this information how to do it while students are doing it, so that they construct cognitive rules, so they construct actually the routines that enable them to perform the routine aspects of the task. And when you look in a skills laboratory, you often see things like this on the wall, giving step-by-step descriptions of how to perform these routine aspects. This is for doing palpitation of the abdomen. involved students are practicing on simulated patients or practicing on each other. They can have a look at the wall just in time so that they know how to do it. Well, you cannot read it, but the idea should be clear. So this just-in-time information, it can be presented by a supervisor. It can be presented by posters on the wall. It's nowadays always also presented on your smartphone. So when a student is required to do a particular procedure, looking at the smartphone how to do it. But augmented reality, Roger was talking about augmented reality. It's also a very powerful way because you're looking at something and then you can project on the goggles how you should do it while you are looking at the object. Okay, still making sense, or are you just longing for lunch? Well, this is the last component. It's part task practice. This is also relevant to the routine aspects of the task. Of course, these routine aspects are trained in the context of our cases or our whole learning tasks. But because the underlying learning process for these routines is different of the learning process for the non-routine aspects of the task, it might be necessary to provide additional practice for this particular routine, so that it becomes automated in the cognitive sense. Heavy examples of part task practice is practicing the multiplication tables from 1 to 10 in primary school. Or when you are playing a musical instrument, practicing the musical scales is an example of part task practice. It's not a whole meaningful task, but it helps you to improve the speed of your fingers when you're playing the piano, or the setting of your mouth when you're playing the trumpet. And automating this particular routine aspect of the skills helps you to become better in performing the whole task. And the same is true in some of the health professions, where it might be helpful to practice particular routine aspects of the whole task additionally, so that it becomes automated. In our model, we will only do part task practice for a particular routine aspect, like giving intravenous injections or doing this palpitation, after this aspect has been introduced in the context of a whole task, so that students understand how practicing this routine aspect might help them to become better in performing the whole task, in doing the clinical reasoning, for example. So that's the cognitive context is important. And then it's repetitive practice, and the underlying learning process is called strengthening, I think both in SOAR and in ACT. Each time you apply this cognitive rule and it yields the desired effects, it's strengthened. And this is the whole schematic representation of what an educational program looks like, taking into account the major guidelines that cognitive science provides us. This is one example of part task practice. This is taken from a blended learning program for general practitioners or family doctors. And the only thing they do here is work on a long list of cases to immediately recognize the most familiar children's diseases. So it's pattern recognition, it's training pattern recognition for the routine aspects of clinical reasoning tasks. I often talk about complex learning. I think Roger was also talking about complex learning. And this is what an educational program that's based on the four components makes it into complex learning. Complex learning is not meaning that the learning is difficult. No, it's meaning that I'm interested in types of learning that allow for transfer from the school to the real world. And my claim is that we can only expect transfer when we simultaneously facilitate inductive learning, learning from concrete experiences, elaboration, learning by connecting new information to what you already know, knowledge compilation, constructing cognitive rules that allow you to perform routine aspects of tasks, and sometimes strengthening of these routine aspects so that they become fully automated. And these are schema construction processes, processes that help learners to construct cognitive schemas. And these are schema automation processes, processes that help learners to automate these cognitive schemas, to form the rules or productions for it. And each of the four components is linked to a basic learning process. So that's what makes it into complex learning, and that's what helps to transfer the things you have learned from school or university to the profession or real life. And this is also a view on learning that is widely supported by research on learning in cognitive psychology and cognitive science. There was a question here? Yeah?
Practical life, there is some ambiguity and some other cases that are not learning in the university. So, is there a procedure to find solutions in that case?
You mean that?
Mm-hmm. Because you are dealing with transfer between the theoretical and the practical.
Yeah. So the question is, I think, how do you take into account that knowledge is quickly changing, yeah, and that practical tasks are quickly changing? Well, without simplifying this issue, I think when you have a curriculum or an educational program where the building blocks are learning tasks, this is the backbone of our program, it is relatively easy, it's still difficult, but it's relatively easy to adapt your educational program to changes in the profession. Because when new technologies come up, you can make sure that you replace particular learning tasks by old learning tasks that introduces new technology. In the medical field, for example, you see that ultrasound techniques are becoming more and more important, also in the undergraduate programs of medical schools. And medical schools that have a traditional disciplinary program where it's not a learning task, but where it are the textbooks that are the basis of the program, have much more difficulty implementing new ultrasound techniques in their program than medical schools that use problem-based learning. Because they can simply replace a set of problems with new problems that require their students to apply ultrasound techniques. Okay, well, when I'm designing educational programs, for me it's like building a skeleton. We have this backbone, of learning tasks from simple to complex, showing this variability, and on each level of complexity, this decrease of support of and guidance, and then we connect the other components to this backbone. So it's an integrated course or an integrated curriculum where all the elements are related to each other. When a teacher is teaching something and I'm asking, how does this help your students to solve particular problems, to do particular reasoning tasks? And the only thing this teacher can say, well, I don't know, but I need it later, there's something wrong in the curriculum. Huh? That's not a good excuse, saying that students need it later, after graduation. No, you should be able to explain how the things you are telling them, teaching them, help them to work on concrete cases, concrete problems, concrete tasks that are also part of the curriculum. Only then we can expect transfer of learning. So conclusions, because it's time. What I try to do is explain a systematic approach to education aimed at clinical reasoning, where I took my examples, but it can also be decision making, problem solving. This model has been applied in many different fields, not only in the medical field, but also in technical fields. I think it has a relatively strong theoretical and empirical basis compared to many other approaches. And current research, a lot of my current research is on individualized learning trajectories, and one of the questions already related to that, but also self-regulated and self-directed learning, where it's up to the learners to select their learning tasks, and where it is up to the learners to select the learning resources they need in order to perform the tasks. And so within this framework, you can also do a lot of interesting work on self-regulation and self-regulated learning, and many of our current projects are dealing with that. Well, these are some references. I think these slides will be distributed. Some references on the model itself, but also some applications of this model for teaching clinical reasoning, both in medicine and in dentistry and in physiotherapy, and I think there are also some examples in nursing and so on. Okay, thank you.